Visit SafeRetirementSolutions.com.
21st Century Radio is sponsored by Hieronimus & Company. This is Talk Radio 680 WCBM. It's time now for award-winning 21st Century Radio with your host, Dr. Zoe Hieronimus.
Everybody needs a helping hand. Take a look at your fellow man and tell me, what can I do today? Because everybody needs a helping hand. If that ain't what it's all about, tell me what, what can I do? What can I do?
Welcome to 21st Century Radio. I'm Dr. Zohara Hieronimus. Laura Kortner is our executive producer, and Anita Brockington runs our board. Our guest this hour has been with us numerous times over the years. Jason Gregory is a teacher and international speaker specializing in the fields of Eastern and Western philosophy, comparative religion, metaphysics, and ancient culture. He is the author of The Science and Practice of Humility and Enlightenment Now, both books we've discussed in the past. This hour, we'll be exploring a wonderful new book he's authored, an Inner Traditions 2017 release entitled Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for the Psychic Detox. It's plain, simple, and clear expose of the differences and similarities of Taoism, Confucianism, Buddhism, Hinduism, and the Western mind. Set in general, shows us how very clearly Westerners need to restore, in our culture collectively and individually, a quiet mind. Learn how meditation on something as close to us as our breath is a tool for emancipation from worry, stress, fear, and chaos in general, which seems to engulf a materialistic culture such as ours. Join us this hour for some life-saving tools that each one of us can employ to make our lives, our health, and spirits more in harmony, more at ease, and therefore the world more at peace. And in fact, he shows the reader how, quote, the only freedom you have is to turn your mind inward and renounce activities there. Stop planning, Gregory says. Stop comparing. Stop competing. Stop thinking. And just breathe deeply for a minute. Thank you so much for joining us, Jason.
Oh, it's great to be back on, Zoe. I always enjoy our exchanges.
Yeah, well, I love this book. It came right in time for me when I was trying to figure out, well, how am I going to manage this quiet mind now that, you know, you hit in your 60s and you look at your toolkit and you go, I did all this stuff in the world. What about my inner world? So in the beginning, yes, your dedication shares that this book is for the creation of a peaceful mind and a peaceful world, making clear that there can be no separation between the two.
Well, they cannot, you know, like, I know a lot of people think that they can have world peace just by, you know, hitting the pavement and you know, we all want world peace, but the problem is we just don't know where that peace originally arises from, a lot of people. And that first begins on our own mind, and then the world itself will just be a natural byproduct of our own peace. But, you know, that's easier said than done when you consider 7.5 billion people on the planet or whatever it is at the moment. But, you know, this is the work that we can all do, is quiet our mind, become peaceful in our own lives, and that itself is the seed of world peace.
You, I love the way you said it. And by the way, I really thought this is a fantastic book, and I want to encourage the audience, if you're not a winner tonight of a copy, buy this book, Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox. It's an Inner Tradition 2017 release. You know, there are a lot of books on the market about meditation, and there aren't a lot that really explain, I think, the roots, as you have, Jason. And you point out that, you know, the epidemic of our time is not a war on terror or a war among nations and religions. You said the truth is we've waged war upon ourselves.
Yeah. Yeah, I believe we have, because what we're the lifestyles we've chose to live, especially in the modern world, is we're not giving ourselves any time to breathe and be naturally who we are, because, you know, we're constantly doing, we're constantly active in life and trying to be somebody else and trying to be someone who society thinks we should be. And so, you know, we're actually subtly, I believe, we're killing ourselves subtle, on a subtle level, especially in the psychological realm, because we're not giving ourselves the time to breathe and allow ourselves to come back to our natural equanimity. So, you know, this is when we're constantly consuming stimulation, we're constant, and, you know, in my book, I focus mainly on what we take in through the eyes and ears, you know, this has a certain effect on our nervous system, which affects our way of being in the world. So constantly consuming this type of energy through our eyes and ears is you know, it's destroying us on a very subtle level. And we're just not aware of this subtle war that we've waged upon ourselves, you know, because we're brought up in a world where we should have access to everything and we should be overstimulated. And, you know, this has become the natural way for people to live in the world. So, you know, you've probably recognized this as well. So, like, when you go out into the world, you see people who are, they have a sense of tension within themselves, a sense of restlessness that they can just not be settled and not be, you know, content with the way life is as it is. And so this subtle tension is developing more and more in the world. And we see this developing through, you know, chronic stress and anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, all of these sort of mental health issues that we see in the world.
We certainly see it in our children who are growing up completely overstimulated by external influences, whether it's the iPad or the video games or whatever it is. But it's this constant drone of input. And we weren't designed to take in this much information and this much stimulation. You know, our DNA hasn't changed much. And yet we're now being overwhelmed. And you, I thought it was a beautiful point you make that, you know, panic attacks, anxiety attacks show us actually that we are, I guess one could say the way you did, that our nervous system is hitting the brakes.
It definitely is. Like if you see the especially the rise in panic attacks in the Western world, you know, America, Australia, Europe, Canada, you know, there's a significant rise in panic attacks, anxiety disorders, and it all comes back on, you know, we just got our foot on the accelerator. We're trying to either be somebody or achieve everything that we can think of, and we don't give ourselves any time to just sort of naturally, you know, sit in, you know, boredom, even just to sit in boredom and just relax and allow your nervous system to come back down into equanimity. You know, we're not allowing that to happen. So, you know, if we don't start to pump the brakes on the way we live our life, then our nervous system's going to continue to be depleted. So, and a lot of people just pass these things off. A lot of people say, oh, well, panic attacks have been around forever. That might be true, but not to the extent that they are at the moment. You know, like back in the ancient times, the real panic attacks were actually real physical threats, you know, like when we were in the savannah and, you know, you got a lion or something chasing you down. Now we don't really have those threats. Our threats now are, you know, oh, how do I look on Instagram, or, you know, I hope I get that job, or I hope they think, you know, good of me. And you know, all of these things that are really not, they're not really big threats, you know. It's really first world problems, you know. So, but we're magnifying these problems into something that they're not, and we're super anxious about being accepted by the world, that we're not okay with just being the way we are.
The other thing, you know, I remember when I first started broadcasting in 1992 as a full time host, there was no internet. And everything I did had to be done through the library or hard copy, you know, newspapers, magazines, research files, etc. The internet came along somewhere with about 6 or 8 years into that, and I noticed an extraordinary change in the sense of the tempo of my own work and the being overwhelmed by not just bad information, but deliberate disinformation. And I find that one of the challenges we have today with the internet and the false information that is promoted and the false images that are manufactured and the fake movies that aren't really stories that represent a life but are extraordinarily violent is that, as you point out, when you take this in through your eyes, your body doesn't know that it's not real. So your autonomic and your regular nervous system is constantly responded to things that you would not necessarily ever encounter in your lifetime.
No, that's true, though. And like you said, with that's a great point, that with the advent of the internet, you know, it's all of that's increased. You know, tenfold, you know, a thousandfold. So, you know, back in the day, like you said, just 1992, which is actually not that long ago, you did everything very, you know, analog. It was all analog. It wasn't digital. And so, you know, I remember those days. I was young at that time, but I, you know, some of my best moments were in my youth when it was, before, you know, pre-internet. So, you know, I talk about in the book that sort of that side of it, where the nervous system, where we're taking in all of this information through the internet, and you know, our body doesn't, like you said, our body doesn't know what it's experiencing. So, you know, when we nut down the science of the nervous system, we have the sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system. So once you're feeding the sympathetic nervous system all of this information and all of this activity and all of this knowledge, that in some sense, a lot of the knowledge and information we take in is really unnecessary and not really aligned with our own path. It's just out there. And so we're taking in all of this stuff, and it's agitating us on a very subtle level and making us restless and want, and with an urge to act unnecessarily, you know. And we're totally suppressing the parasympathetic nervous system, which is more of the rest and digest system, which can only be accessed through complete inactivity. So, you know, that's why meditation is very important, and why, you know, just sitting quietly and doing nothing is important. But we don't really value that anymore, because especially with what you said with the internet, we're promoting this very active go-get-em attitude, and you should know this and know that. You know, like if we look at, for example, both you and I, so when we were, say, 10 years old, we never had phones or anything like that. And the children now, they, you know, I've seen this, I forget where it was, maybe it was in Thailand, someone said, oh yeah, I know that. And they were like a 12-year-old kid, but they Googled it up, and they thought they knew the subject just because they read the brief, you know.
Right.
So,
like members of Congress.
Exactly.
I just had to say that.
Yeah, exactly. So you see members of Congress, that they're afflicted with the soundbite culture, you know. So it's that's the world we're developing, and you really don't know knowledge that well if you're just reading a brief, you know, on Google, or you watched a 5-minute YouTube clip. You can't know anything, you know, very deeply, actually, I don't believe, you know. So, but that's the culture that we're developing.
And the other one, I was listening to a beautiful talk given recently by Andrew Weil on tape, one of his books, I don't remember which one, and he was talking about, you know, what has now been called the nature deficit disorder. And this is not just some sort of elegant discussion about children who don't have enough nature access. It's about the entire Western population. And we see it in the ruination of nature, and we see it in this extinction phase we are influencing and making worse by this divorce from our understanding that we are nature. So we're going to take a little break, and when we come back, I'd like to move into where you have spent so much of your work and done such a beautiful job, which is showing us how the ancient traditions of the East, while everybody thinks that they were all the same, are very different. They shared some similarities and some very clear differences in how they approach the science of mind. Our guest is Jason Gregory, a superb book, Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox. It's an Inner Traditions 2017 release, and you can learn more about Jason's work at jasongregory.org.
Hello, this is Dr. Daniel Four, author of Ancestral Medicine, Rituals for Personal and Family Healing. You can learn more about me and my work at ancestralmedicine.org. You're listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zohara Hieronimus.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. Our guest this portion of our program is Jason Gregory. His book, Fasting for the Mind, Spiritual Exercises. It's not for the mind, it's Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox. It's an Inner Traditions 2017 release. You can learn more about Jason's work and where he speaks at jasongregory.org. So as your book points out, fasting the mind, if we don't adequately rest the nervous system, we can participate in what I guess could be called unconscious acts of violence, which may express itself as irritability, impatience, anger, cruelty, lack of empathy. We see it all around us culturally today. And in this particular administration, it's a tool for some reason that is so destructive to the culture overall and to the world in general. So let's talk about coming back to the teachings of the Buddhist or others that you talk about, Confucianism or Taoism, and how they approach this resting the mind.
Well, yeah, actually the term fasting the mind came from the great Taoist sage Zhuangzi. So he would, you know, his approach, there was actually a passage in the classic Zhuangzi text which said there was in the Zhuangzi text, he plays the mouthpiece of Confucius. He doesn't usually like Confucius, but in this sense he's using Confucius as a sage, and Yan Wei is Confucius's disciple, and Yan Wei has this idea of, you know, reforming an unruly king in Western China who's like greedy and, you know, treats the people with no respect and so forth and so on. And so Yan Wei has all of these elaborate plans to make him, you know, a good leader, and Confucius shoots all these down and said that what you have to do is you have to fast. And he thought, you know, I fast the body all the time, but he said, no, you have to fast the mind, meaning you have to get rid of all of that, all of your notions of how you're going to change this person, and just be completely present with them. And this, in a roundabout way, according to Zhuangzi, has a way of affecting the leader. Like, so he doesn't want him to go there and try to change him, you know, directly. He wants him to change him through his own way of being, his own actions, and his own way of life. So that was like that's where the term fasting the mind came from. And that sort of approach is kind of all through Asia, they have that sort of approach, but it does differ between Buddhism, the Vedic civilization, and Taoism. But you know, when we see like Lao Tzu and Confucius specifically, you know, Lao Tzu has a very what would you say, like more of a renunciate way of approaching these certain situations that we have in the world, where he says that people have the reason because they're so engaged with the world, they've lost contact with their true nature, and so they have to have a return back to nature. You know, he doesn't really specifically mean nature as in, you know, going back into the trees and the jungle, whatnot. But he wouldn't say there's anything wrong with that. But returning to your true nature, where you're not trying to change the world according to your own opinion, but you're just you're focused on yourself, and that in turn, like we talked about earlier, so will change the world. So that was like a kind of a common Taoist approach, as opposed to Confucius, who he sort of comes from the strict discipline of self-cultivation and creating superior people in society, which you can see the benefit of that as well, you know, because a lot of people are undisciplined in the world. And yeah, especially when it comes to distractions and taking in all of this information and becoming agitated, and which leads, like as you said before, leads to people acting uncharacteristically, you know. So you can see his point of view there. And when we go back even further, back to the Vedic civilization, if you look at the caste system, the Hindu caste system, before it became, you know, out of control in more of the modern times, is that there was kind of everyone had their duty, their so-called dharmic social duty, where they would fulfill that till they're about 45, and then they would leave society and become a vanaprastha and break away from society to transform themselves, but to give themselves to Brahman, which is like the ultimate reality, or think of God. And Western civilization, and that in turn, the difference is that the idea there is they would go away, and in the Vedic civilization they would just go away forever. But when we look at the Zhuangzi, text, he would say that that is important to get away for that specific time. Like, you know, it could be a year or two, 5 years, who knows? It takes for someone, each person, to transform themselves. But the return to society was important. You know, as Joseph Campbell said, bringing back the boon, so to speak, which helps to transform society. So, but getting back closer into the practices, you know, it's all about the mind management and about how we can stop this agitated mind. And that goes back to further back into the Vedic civilization with the philosophy of neti neti and practices like that, which is about observing the mind and understanding the differences between your agitated mind and your natural, present, pure awareness. And that's kind of, that sort of perspective is kind of universal among a lot of Eastern traditions, but it's explained in many different ways.
And it is also in the Western mystery traditions, both of Judaism and others. I mean, I've studied it and I thought it was so interesting. Neti Neti is basically similar to the Jewish teaching that there's no duality. You know, it's never a question of this or that. It's always this and that. But we live in a society that it constantly makes you think you have to choose between this and that, and that there can never be, you know, the sense of having both these qualities in your life, whether it's up and down or in and out, inside, outside, you know, yes and no, that we in the West have used such logical rationalism that we have created our own obstacles, really, for being able to not only enjoy the pleasure of the created world, but to participate in it as an active kind of agent of the Tao, or an agent of spirit, or however somebody wants to call it or term it. It's being available to the higher mind, intuition, and the heart. And I loved the fact that you talked about our psychosomatic organism. You know, we have food, and we have liquid, and we have air, and then we have the impressions, as you pointed out, that we take from our ears and our eyes and our nose and our mouth. Some call these the seven holy gates. And you show this, that going back to Egypt and the six gates and the sixth sense philosophy.
Yeah, it's true. It goes back even to ancient Egypt, where you have the nine gates of the body, which are the two eyes, the two nostrils, the two ears, the mouth, penis or vagina, and the anus. And so you have these gates, which, you know, when we're conscious, you're supposed to guard. And because the idea is that because the energy we take in, the energy that we consume, comes in through, you know, obviously, as you mentioned, so mainly through what we have on our head, you know, so through our nose, through our eyes, our ears, our mouth. And that sort of energy will affect our psychosomatic organism, what we're taking in. And, you know, the culture we have now, obviously we're taking in a lot of toxic energy, toxic food, toxic impressions, you know, toxic air. And this is affecting us on a subtle level. And going back into Egypt, they have the related to the nine gates of the body is the sixth sense philosophy, where, you know, we have the natural five senses, and the way that the five senses, the energy we consume through our five senses affects the sixth sense, which is either, you know, you can think of thoughts, or even it's sometimes translated as mind. So, you know, what a lot of people are taking in, that itself is agitating the sixth sense. So that's why we have a lot of people who their thoughts are always racing, their mind is constantly agitated, going back to here and there. And, you know, a lot of people have no sense of equanimity or just stillness in their mind a lot of the time, because they're thinking about the future or what happened in the past.
Or the movie they watched before going to bed, which was filled with killing and car crashes and death. I mean,
exactly.
I don't know how people think you can watch that, or that you can have your children watch this, and that it's not affecting them unconsciously and subliminally, and then in their nervous system, and then consciously. And we want to know why there are children now that will pick up a gun and go kill other children. Well, when
exactly.
You grow up with a diet of violence, your body literally becomes used to doing violence. And
yes.
It no longer has the capacity to feel with compassionate awareness what other life feels. So let's talk a little bit about how anybody in the listening audience can do an open awareness meditation. That seems to be one we can talk about, and then we can also talk about using our breathing. You know, people often think that meditation has to be very complicated. You have to go far away. You have to spend a lot of money. And I'm here to share with you Jason Gregory, who will show you, no. In about 2 minutes, you're going to know how to meditate.
Exactly. But that was a good point. So the open awareness and the breath meditation, well, they're two of the ones I recommend the most. So open awareness meditation is very simple. It's something practiced in Zen, specifically in Zazen. And it's basically about not trying to control the mind. It's about sitting present, allowing your mind to do what it is, but just to open your awareness to whatever is around you. You know, this is why sometimes sounds, being in nature, and that can benefit meditation. But, you know, even better is if you're in a very silent place, like if you have a specific meditation room, or if you're in a cave, if you're lucky.
There's a lot of family people say, yes, I go in the bathroom and close the door and the kids can't bother me.
Exactly. So yeah, this open awareness meditation is very simple. You sit present and you sit in a stable posture and you keep your awareness open. You allow your mind to go here and there, but just pay attention to where your mind is going. And the sounds around you. It's very simple. And the more you do that, the more your mind starts to settle and it comes back into a natural state of equanimity. The mind will keep bouncing up, but the more you keep training your mind like that, the more it will cease the activity. And this will begin to affect your normal life. And, you know, I used to practice open awareness meditation a lot when I was younger, and it helps to settle the mind and allow you to be more present in, you know, just everyday life, in conversations or in, you know, exchanges with people or strangers. And that's such an easy meditation to do.
And the freedom, what I like about that so much is that no matter where you are and what you're doing, let's say at the office you have a run-in with a coworker or a boss, or on the highway, you know, somebody wants to cut you off rather than let you get off the highway safely, that this is something you can go immediately into in order to calm your own nervous system down so that you don't respond in an agitated, angry, or out-of-control way to things that will constantly happen around us. I mean, it doesn't matter who we are, where we live, or what our age is. There are always going to be things around us that annoy us, that, you know, get on our nerves, that irritate us, maybe make us angry. And this tool allows us to watch ourselves so that we can learn what our triggers are and how we automatically respond without control, so that we then learn some sense of control over ourselves. Because I really appreciate, Jason, what you said, and I've come to find the same thing, that the ultimate freedom is within. And that's why Nelson Mandela and others who have been in prison said they found their greatest freedom, because what they learned to do was rest their minds.
Exactly, exactly. Well, that's, you know, that's the most important part. And, you know, I think if you're incapable of resting your mind, then you're not going to be very effective in the world, and you'll probably just continue to live the life you've always lived. You know, that's why these practices are so important. And, you know, I also wanted to mention, to go back to the breathing aspect, which is one I've practiced more so than open awareness meditation, it comes from a Pali word, anapanasati, which is awareness of breath or awareness of respiration. And they practice this in, people are probably familiar, who are listening, familiar with Vipassana meditation. And this is kind of the core of Vipassana meditation. But you don't think of Vipassana meditation in the sense of just a 10-day course, because Vipassana meditation is something you can practice every day. If you have a lot of time, of, you know, even 20 minutes, you can practice Vipassana meditation.
I'm generous to people. I go, if you have 5 minutes, try that.
Try that.
Let's start easy.
Start small. Yeah, start small. 5 minutes is good. And all you have to do is be aware of your breath. Now, what I always tell people to do, the mistake they make when they first get into meditation is they want to stop their thoughts. Now, I say to them, don't try and stop your thoughts. Become aware of distractions. This is the key point. So what breath does is if you have that anchor of the breath, and I mean natural breathing here, not deep breathing or anything like that, just being aware of your natural breathing, is when the thoughts naturally, you know, bubble up and distract your attention and take you off down the rabbit hole of stories and whatnot, you know, be aware of that and come back to the breath. Now, what that does is over time is you'll notice the gap between when your attention gets distracted by your mental activity, then it'll begin to decrease. So this will happen obviously over time, over many years, and this will naturally affect your everyday life because you'll be much more present in everything you do, and your mind won't take you on down the rabbit hole of your own, you know, imagination and stories that we have constantly rattling around in our skull. So that's one of the best meditation practices, you know, I could explain to anyone, is the awareness of respiration, because it just continues to force you to be aware of the distractions in your mind, and also obviously in the external world, but mainly within your mind, where you know, to be honest, we're mainly distracted within our own mind. So, and you know, a good point what you mentioned before, Zoe, is when you're talking about the subconscious, which I didn't get into much. When we look in Sanskrit, we look at samskaras, whereas the subconscious subliminal impressions. It's what people don't understand when they practice mindfulness and meditation is the reason why people can't meditate properly or deeply is because of what they consume outside of their meditation practice. So, you know, if you've been up all night and you're sitting on Twitter and tweeting all night, that's going to affect your morning practice. So it's important what we do outside of our meditation practice. So, you know, a lot of people got to think about that. A lot of people that I've trained in meditation say, oh, I can't go deeply. And I say, well, you're always playing with your smartphone, you know. So, and like what you said before, Zoe, you're watching violent films and so forth and so on. This is affecting your subconscious on a very deep level and giving you unnatural thoughts and imaginations in your mind, which are distracting your practice and always taking you away from your natural settled mind. So that's one of the key points that a lot of meditation teachers don't teach. You have to be mindful of what you're doing in your ordinary life.
The interesting thing about all of that subliminal poison that happens in our culture out of Hollywood and in the news and repetitive broadcasting, I mean, people watch it repetitively. We know that it affects us neurophysiologically. We know that it affects our respiration. We know that it affects our brain waves. I mean, this has all been proven. So there's nothing unknown about how debilitating this kind of diet of violence has become for our global community, and that the more you watch it and the more that it's created and the more that we consume it, the more normal it begins to appear, as if it's normal to shoot your neighbor, as if it's normal to machete off an arm, or it's normal to kill a child, or, you know, and we all know this is extremely aberrant behavior. There's nothing natural about it. And I think the tragedy is that so many children, especially now, never have the grace of being children. You know, they're in constant fear, constant flight. Our adrenal glands are in hyperactivity. Hyper and hypothyroid is now epidemic worldwide. I mean, there are all kinds of things we could add to it in terms of environmental impacts and the food we eat, but it is primarily from the culture's appetite and desire for violence. At least this is my opinion. I've watched this grow over my lifetime. You know, I can barely watch the news anymore. I don't watch movies with violence. I can't, even if they're science fiction. I just can't. And the other thing I think that's important to mention, we do have to take our last break of the evening, is the value of silence and quiet. You know, people say, well, you're a broadcaster, you talk all the time. And I did for 10 years. And then when I finished after 10 years, I took a year off and was in silence for almost a year. I didn't listen to anything. I could barely even listen to my own voice, my husband's voice, everybody's voice just irritated me. So there is something really important about having quiet in our daily lives, having time away from others speaking, communicating, your own communicating, your telephone, your email, your texting, that it's very important to sit with quiet for yourself at least a half hour a day if you can't do more. It's a really good way to start. We'll be right back. Our guest is Jason Gregory. His 2017 Inner Traditions release, Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox.
Hello, this is Lisa Smart, author of Words at the Threshold. You can learn more about me and my work at www.finalwordsproject.org. You are listening to 21st Century Radio with Dr. Zohara Hieronimus. Zoe is a well-informed and thoughtful interviewer. What a pleasure it was to speak with her this evening about the mystery and magic of final words.
Welcome back to 21st Century Radio. I'm Zoe Hieronimus. If you know the name of our guest this hour, he has authored another book, this one entitled Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox. It's an Inner Traditions 2017 release. And if you call us at 410-922-6680, that's 410-WCBM-680, or toll free 1-800-922-6680, and can tell us the name of our guest this hour, you'll be a winner of his book, Fasting the Mind. So I want to come back to a number of things you talk about, which is hot and cold cognition systems, and that you mentioned that when we overexert our wills to make something happen, be it in our own lives or in the world, we're basically sort of endangering our own place in the world and what it is we're actually trying to accomplish.
Yeah, but it's a big topic. So, well, first of all, to understand that, you have to understand the cold and hot cognition. So the cold cognition, if people don't know what that is basically the cognitive state of, when we think of our sense of I, Jason or Zoe, and this is the cognitive control centers that are in the prefrontal cortex of the mind. So, you know, this is our rational part of our mind where we can do this and do that. And, you know, it's the manager, the one who thinks about things, does things, so forth and so on. And then there's the hot cognition, which is located more in the unconscious regions of the brain. And that's more of the spontaneous, natural cognition that, you know, makes us open and close our hands, spontaneously react to something in the environment, makes us also great at things. It's what makes a star athlete flow in their performance, or a musician just do a great performance without having to think about it, you know. And a lot of people in those states, they will say that the sense of I had disappeared in that performance. And so this is one of the key points of what you were talking about, so because the way that our world has evolved, especially now, is we're focused more on the cold cognitive side of being a individual and someone in society separate from the world. And so this is causing, you know, a world of, you know, the world where you and the world are separate from each other. And this happened over evolution naturally, because if we look at Western and Eastern cultures, in the West, the West evolved mainly from Greece, and this was no fault of the West. It's just the way that the culture evolved, where people were more in smaller communities and the activities were more individual, you know. So we would live along the Mediterranean, hunting, herding, and fishing. You can do all their sole activities. And this activity naturally developed more of the prefrontal cortex. So the cold rational aspect, you know, hence why most of the Western world, you know, obviously comes from Europe, and it's much more rational, much more logical. But then when we look at the East, they were in larger communities, specifically in China and India, because of rice cultivation. You know, you had to be in these sort of communities to survive. So you naturally had to lower your ego, lower your sense of I and just be part of that community. And ironically, a lot of the Eastern philosophies are much more holistic because of that reason, because of that cognitive reason, as opposed to a lot of philosophies in the West. So, you know, the problem is that in the world we live in now, that sort of holistic state is being suppressed, where self-interest and individualism is being promoted in the world. So
we certainly see that, you know, online, just this gross narcissism everywhere. Absolutely. People thinking to tell somebody they're going to the grocery store and what they're going to wear is somehow or other news and important for everybody to know. And it's so tragic. You know, I like the fact that you pointed out, as have others, that artists, authors, philosophers tend to be able to reach this other place of non-ego in the journey of the doing of the work, or what some have called deep work, where you've deep concentration. And some people, I think that's why I think hobbies are so important, because people can lose their sense of ego while they're knitting or doing carpentry or working on their engines or whatever it is that is a hobby. These are really important things to do, and our culture doesn't really emphasize hobby like it used to. I mean, that used to be a part of the Western culture.
Yeah, well, exactly for the reason you said too, Zoe. It's, you know, it gives you that time to come back to that effortless state with where you don't have to be a person. You like you said, you're knitting. I remember my mother, she would crochet on the couch all day, you know.
Right.
And you know, that those sort of hobbies, like you said, they're not promoted in the world no more. And there's usually only a very small population of people who take their hobbies into a more of a profession, where, you know, they begin to live that life, you know, like you mentioned, an athlete or an artist. So there sort of needs to be a bit more of a revival of hobbies for people to, I think, to keep their sanity, and to also give them time to downregulate that sense of I, that sense of being a person all the time, being, you know, having that anxiety. Like you said before, perfectly, you know, this is what I'm wearing to dinner. This is what, you know, this is me on social media. And it becomes, you know, a bit of a chore to try and uphold that sense of person.
Another point you make that I think is so important is about consecrating our homes. You know, unfortunately, the New Age movement, as good as it was, also had a poor side effect, which was everything got very expensive that dealt with the inner traditions. And I don't happen to share that notion that you have to pay a lot of money to learn what is natural as a human. You just need somebody to give you a few pointers and a little guidance, and it can be done very safely. It's not to make a career, you know, it's not to go perform yogic feats of competition, because that's not really yoga. That's athleticism, and it wasn't the purpose of yoga. Talk to us a bit about consecrating our home so that we each know our holiness.
Well, consecrating our home is very important. That in itself is a practice, because, you know, if you treat your home as a temple, that itself is going to cultivate, you know, a much more equanimous state of mind. So it's very important. You know, a lot of people treat their home as just a place where they come home, they eat, and they sleep. But your home should be treated as a temple.
When you look at all the different traditions you've studied and this particular focus, other than what we mentioned earlier about the open awareness meditation, where you don't try to control your mind, you just observe what your mind is observing, I did want to add one fascinating exercise I was given about 15 years ago, which is as you go to sleep at night, hold on to your last thought. When you wake up in the morning, write down your first thought and what you remember as your last thought. And you will be amazed. I don't want to tell you what happens, but it's a very useful journeying to actually see that there's some continuity between the conscious and unconscious mind, even though we might not, you know, pay it respect. But the other one you mentioned also is focusing on our breathing, and just at any time, just focus on your breathing. If you feel out of control, or you feel stressed, or you have fear, or you're anxious, or you're in pain, whatever it is, just stop for a second, focus on your breath and your attention to your breath, and it really does calm down the autonomic nervous system. Is there any other small exercise in the last little bit of time we have? I think we lost our guest. Well, the gentleman who has been with us this hour is Jason Gregory. His book is entitled Fasting for the Mind. Fasting the Mind, not for. Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox. And you can find his work online at www.jasongregory.org. I think it's a beautiful book. It does a great job of delineating the many traditions of the East and the challenges we have in the West to rediscover our natural self and the way in which we can each come into greater harmony. And I have found that doing these practices, I'm no master at any of it. I'm still a student and I'm always learning more things. But I have found the breathing, focusing on the breath, absolutely the most fantastic tool in my toolkit today. And there's a good reason for it, because we all breathe if we're alive. So the benefit of using your breath, as the Buddhists do, and the Buddhists use this a lot, as do the Taoists, the most important thing about it is that you don't have to do anything. You know, yes, there are traditions of pranayama yoga. That's a form of breathing and yoga, and you can do all different kinds of breathing exercises. But this is something much simpler, where you just breathe in your normal way. You focus your mind on your breathing, and it really, some people would say, well, that's a distraction. Well, it's a healthy distraction if that's what you want to think of it, but what it really is a very calming tool that we always have with us. They teach it in the schools now for children, when children are hyperactive or they misbehave. In many of the schools where mindfulness is now taught, they have seen an absolute decrease in bullying, a much greater increase in self-moderation, and an ability for children to appreciate that we're all different and that their differences aren't necessarily liabilities. So I think it's a really beautiful thing to add to your life, to your grandchildren's lives, to your friends' lives, to your group life, to your church, to your social groups. Just take a few minutes and in silence focus on your breath, and the silence and the breathing is completely restorative. And we thank Jason Gregory for being with us. Fasting the Mind, Spiritual Exercises for Psychic Detox.
Stay connected and stay informed on the number one news talk station, Talk Radio 680, WCBM, Baltimore, and WCBM.com.